Hey everyone, my name is Tyler Etheridge. I'm with the Department of Ophthalmology and Visual Sciences at the University of Wisconsin School of Medicine and Public Health. And in collaboration with Dr. Jennifer Larson, I will be presenting on cataracts. The objectives of our talk include the anatomy of the lens, epidemiology of cataracts, the definition and description of cataracts, the etiology and risk factors for cataract development, symptoms of cataracts, a quick review of common types of cataracts, the examination of a patient with suspected cataracts, and briefly we'll cover cataract surgery. So the lens is a biconvex, clear crystalline structure that focuses images on the retina. It's suspended by filamentous zonules from the ciliary body between the iris anteriorly and the vitreous posteriorly. Contraction of the ciliary muscle leads to relaxation of the zonules, which allows the lens to become more spherical. As the axial thickness of the lens increases, the refractive power also increases, allowing the eye to change focus from distant to near objects through a process called accommodation. The lens is enclosed in a transparent basement membrane called the capsule. The capsule surrounds a single layer of epithelial cells anteriorly, as well as the lens cortex and nucleus. The lens doesn't have a blood supply or innervation, so it actually receives its nourishment from the surrounding aqueous and vitreous fluid. The normal lens grows throughout life as the epithelial cells enclosed in the capsule produce new cortical fibers. And interestingly, the normal lens is approximately 35% protein by mass, but this percentage increases as the lens ages and cataracts develop. Although some degree of cataract formation is expected over the age of 70, due to the natural aging process of the lens, cataracts are the most common cause of decreased vision that's not correctable with glasses worldwide. Cataract surgery is one of the most common and successful surgeries, with approximately 2 million cataract extractions performed per year in the United States alone. Cataracts are defined as any opacity or discoloration of the lens. However, clinically, we use the term cataract for opacities that impair vision. Cataracts are typically described according to the zone of the lens that's involved, including the subcapsular, cortical, and nuclear. However, opacities can involve more than one zone. Their location can be further specified as either anterior or posterior, and cataracts can also be described according to their stage of development, with immature cataracts signifying that there's clear cortex still present, and mature cataracts signifying a totally opacified cortex. The most common cause of cataract is age-related. Other factors include trauma, inflammation, metabolic and nutritional defects, and the use of corticosteroids. Some cataracts can occur as a result of a congenital or genetic anomaly. Risk factors for cataract development include increasing age, UV light exposure, diabetes, corticosteroids, smoking, history of trauma to the eye or surgery, certain eye diseases such as uveitis, and a genetic predisposition. Cataracts result in loss of the lens's optical quality, which produces many visual symptoms, including blurry vision, glare such as halos, streaks, and or starbursts around lights, which often leads to difficulty seeing in bright lights, problems seen in low light situations, resulting in poor night vision, an inability to distinguish contrast between objects in their background, loss of color discrimination, and the second sight phenomenon, which refers to a temporary improvement in distance vision in patients with hyperopia, and near vision in patients with emmetropia. Patients can also complain of double vision in one eye, termed monocular diplopia. It's important to note that the degree of visual disability caused by cataracts depend both on their size as well as their location. For example, axial cataracts affecting either the nucleus or the central subcapsular area are typically more disabling than peripheral cataracts. Although there are many types of cataracts, we'll review the most common. Nuclear sclerotic cataracts occur as the lens's nucleus yellows and hardens over time. The image on the top left shows an angled slit lamp beam passing through the cornea, which is visible as a thin beam of light on the left-hand side of the image, and striking the lens on the right-hand side of the image, highlighting the central green-brown color of the lens's nucleus. The image on the bottom right shows increasing yellow to brown discoloration of the lens over time. Cortical cataracts occur as the fibers of the lens's cortex, which surrounds the nucleus, become opacified. They typically don't cause visual disability until they approach the center of the visual axis. The image on the top illuminates the spoke-like opacity in the lens, and the image on the bottom uses a technique called retroillumination to highlight the opacity protruding from the periphery into the center of the lens. Posterior subcapsular cataracts develop in the most posterior layer of the cortex, which is directly beneath the lens's capsule, shown in the top left image by the arrowhead and the bottom right image. When evaluating a patient with concern for cataracts, the primary objectives are to determine if the opacity is causing visual impairment, if the opacity accounts for the level of vision, or if there's another coexisting disease, if removal of the cataract will likely improve vision, and whether it's worth the risk of cataract surgery, as well as whether the patient can tolerate the surgery and postoperative care. Patients with reduced vision require a complete exam. Visual function is usually assessed by measuring visual acuity, both with and without correction. If a patient reports significant glare, brightness acuity testing, which uses an instrument that mimics glare while assessing visual acuity, can be used. Visual fields by confrontation and extraocular motility are assessed, as well as the direct and indirect pupillary response. It's important to note that even advanced cataracts do not produce an afferent pupillary defect. The intraocular pressure is measured and a slit lamp exam is performed, which provides a magnified view of the eye, aiding in describing the type, severity, and location of the cataract, as well as assessing the integrity of the zonules that support the lens. A dilated fundus exam is required to assess the optic nerve and macula for any disease that can be contributing to the vision loss. However, if the cataract is so severe and the ophthalmologist can't see to the back of the eye, ultrasound may be required. Cataract surgery is one of the most common and successful surgeries. It's been associated with improved quality of life, reduced risk of falls, and fewer motor vehicle accidents in patients with visually significant cataracts. Although there are different types of cataract surgery, the goals are the same: to remove the cataract and replace it with an artificial intraocular lens. The term phakic means an individual has their own natural lens. Pseudophakic means the natural lens is removed and replaced with an artificial intraocular lens. And aphakic means the natural lens was removed, but it wasn't replaced, and the patient is without a lens. For more information on cataract surgery, visit the American Academy of Ophthalmology's website. We've reviewed a lot in this lecture, including the anatomy of the lens, the epidemiology of cataracts, definition and description, etiology and risk factors for cataract development, symptoms of cataracts, common types, the examination of a patient with cataracts, and the surgical treatment of cataracts.